that this is going to happen more and more. It's happening earlier and earlier to kids. And parents are out there trying to manage this all on their own. There's no manual for how to manage social media for your kids. There's no set of ideal practices for how to tailor your kids' needs to the evolving nature of social media. That's actually why I believe that parents need to also come together and support one another, you know, around taking a set of shared rules, so that not only is it easier for us, but it's easier for our kids. When we tell our kid, for example, as my wife and I are planning to do for our kids, that we are not going to consider them being on social media until at least after middle school, it will be helpful to us if there are other parents in our friend community, in our school community, who are doing the same. Because then we can say, no, you're not the only one, but Bobby and Mary and Jack are also waiting until after middle school.
And are there other parents who want to do the same, to wait until after middle school, or have you guys done it for school?
Well, so this is what has been fascinating. I'm seeing even in our own school community, like the last few weeks ago, there was an enormous conversation in our school about how to manage technology for our kids. And there are many more parents than I had even realized in our school who want to wait until later. But the reason many don't is because they want to assume that everyone is just doing this. They don't want their kid to be left out. So this is a collective action problem. But many of them are also unsure how to manage some of those harms, or may not be sure what the harms are. And there's a lot of pressure too. You know, the number of parents I talk to who say, my child came up to me and said, if you don't let me open up an account on social media, I'll be the only one in my class. I'll be left out. Do you want me to be more lonely? And if you're a parent, face that, of course you don't want your child to be lonely. So I really feel for parents, because our kids shouldn't be alone in this, and we shouldn't be alone either as parents in managing social media.
So as the daughter of parents who decided that their child should not have a television, I can identify with those kids who say, I feel more lonely. You're not part of the conversation. You can't participate in the games because you don't hear and you don't see. And it is difficult. It's the hardest thing for them, right? Are you worried that could happen to you? That, you know, your kids would, you would somehow kind of deepen the loneliness? I mean, you yourself were a lonely child growing up, you said. How do you think about this?
Well, this is why I think it's so important for us to build this broader movement together, to re-engineer the relationship that our kids have with technology. Because imagine if we delay the age at which kids start using social media. Imagine even after they use social media, if we build tech-free zones in their lives, in their days, to protect sleep, in-person interaction, physical activity, and learning. Think about what we would do and could do with that time. I think about the school in Indiana that I went to, which had put in place restrictions around the use of social media and phones during class time. And they said that what they noticed was kids started playing games together in the library and in the hallway. They were talking more. The volume in the hallways went up. And this has been one of the most striking things to me about the college tour that I've done. I remember college as a time where the most noisy place on campus was the dining room. Because everyone is coming together to talk about what they did, and you barely hear yourself think.
Right.
These days, when I go to college campuses, particularly the dining halls, it's quiet because people are on their devices, they're listening to music on their iPod, they're on their laptops. And one of the most chilling questions that I got on the college tour again and again from kids was, how are we supposed to build connection with one another when the culture isn't for people to talk to each other anymore? Just think about that for a minute. They're saying the culture is not for people to talk to each other anymore. We have to rebuild the spaces where people can talk to each other, where our kids can talk to each other, where they can discover things together, where they can agree and disagree together, but where they can do that in a way that helps them build healthy relationships, negotiate disagreement, and build friendships.
So let's say that Congress goes along with this, and one way they start to appear on social media online. We're now almost 20 years since the advent of the smartphone. 2007 was the first iPhone. I remember getting one. Entire generations have formed their habits around these devices. And, you know, as we've discussed, there have been some real benefits, but also there are some steep societal costs. Someone I read somewhere put it that, you know, our kids are now this giant human, real-time, real-life laboratory of what all of this is going to mean. So is a label actually still going to unwind that? You know, is it too late to unwind this?
I don't think it's too late. I think about smoking in our country in 1964, when the first Surgeon General's report on tobacco was issued. At that time, 42% of Americans smoked. There were advertisements everywhere for smoking that kids could see. It was just seen as part of the culture. And there were people at that time who said, the notion that you're going to get people to stop smoking just seems unrealistic. But the combination of not just a report, but all of the action that that report helped to promote and unleash, community education programs, advocacy from parents, legislation from Congress and from state and local legislatures, together over the years, that helped us take us from 42% to below 12%. That helped us save countless lives. So is it going to be easy to change and re-engineer our relationship to social media to make social media safer? No, it's not going to be easy. It's going to be complicated. But I firmly believe that as a nation, America can do hard things. We've done hard things before. And what better time than on this issue of what's at stake is a mental health and well-being of our kids.
Do your kids know what your job is?
My kids now know that I'm the Surgeon General, but I don't know that they know what that means. They know that I wear a uniform, and they know that I do a lot of interviews and talks, but I'm not sure that they entirely know what my day job is. They just know it has to do with health. In my house, when you ask who's a doctor in the house,
yeah,
my kids point to my wife. And we often have to remind them that, hey, daddy's a doctor too. So it's one of the humbling things about being a parent, and I love it.
Do they know anything about what you did this week?
They know that I was doing a lot of media because they saw me on TV here and there when they were walking past their grandparents' television. But they don't really know otherwise. They don't really know really what social media is at this point, but that is going to change any day now. It's coming.
Do you think that potentially what we do now means that they will be more protected?
I hope so, yeah. I mean, we do the work we do as parents. I do the work I do as a dad. Not only because I want to serve, but because I want the world to be better for my kids. And that's what that's been here too. You know, I want my kids to grow up in a world where the technology and the tools that are in front of them help them, don't harm them. I want them to grow up in a world where we are more connected with one another, where they can build friendships and they can seek out other kids who may be struggling with loneliness and help them feel less alone and know that there's somebody who's got their back. If I've learned one thing, you know, in my life, it's that we really do need each other. My wife and I, as much as we love our kids, we can't make sure the whole world is safe for them by ourselves. We can't make sure that they grow and encounter healthy levels of adversity just on our own. This is something we've got to do together as parents. And so I do hope that the work that I do will have some small contribution to making the world better for them. But I also know that to fulfill that hope, it's going to take all of us working hand in hand and keeping our North Star clear, which is ultimately taking care of our kids. Because as a dad, I just don't know what's more important than that.
Dr. Monthy, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much, Sabrina. I really appreciate the chance to talk with you about this.
You can hear more discussion of the Surgeon General's social media recommendation on this week's episode of Hard Fork. We'll be right back. Can the Earth be protected from space rocks?
My name is Ed Liu. I'm a former NASA astronaut, and I'm currently the executive director of the Asteroid Institute. Google Cloud has enabled a very small team at the Asteroid Institute to do the work of what 5 or 10 years ago would have been hundreds of engineers. And that's what we need in order to sort through billions of images of the sky, find asteroids in those images, and figure out where those asteroids are going.
Learn more about the potential of AI at Google Cloud at g.co/cloud. Here's what else you should know today. On Thursday, the Supreme Court upheld a tax on foreign income that helped finance the tax cuts that President Donald Trump imposed in 2017, in a case that many experts have cautioned could undercut the nation's tax system. The vote was 7-2, with Justice Brett Kavanaugh writing the majority opinion. He was joined by Chief Justice John Roberts and by the court's three liberals. The ruling avoided what many feared could have been fiscal chaos by upholding, for now, the structure of the income tax system. And Donald Sutherland, the actor who played a laid-back battlefield surgeon in the television series MASH and a soulful father in the movie Ordinary People, died on Thursday in Miami at the age of 88. Sutherland was known for his wide range. He had the ability to both charm and unsettle, to reassure and repulse. Across 6 decades, starting in the early 1960s, he appeared in nearly 200 films and television shows. Some years, he was in as many as half a dozen movies. A quick reminder to catch a new episode of The Interview right here tomorrow. This week, Lulu Garcia Navarro talks with Michigan Governor Gretchen Whitmer about why she wants to meet one of the men convicted of plotting to kidnap her in 2020.
I'd like to understand what drove this group of people to undergo this exercise to try to kidnap me and kill me. I want to understand it. What is happening?
You think there's something to understand?
Maybe. Maybe there's not. But I'd like to see.
Today's episode was produced by Lindsay Garrison, Rob Zipko, Alex Stern, and Ricky Novetsky. It was edited by Lexi Diao and Michael Benoit. Contains original music by Dan Powell and Chelsea Daniel, and was engineered by Alyssa Moxley. Special thanks to Ellen Berry. Our theme music is by Jim Brunberg and Ben Landsberg of Wonderly. For the Daily. I'm Sabina Tavarese. See you on Monday. How can AI help the farmers who are feeding the world? Jiva is using AI from Google Cloud to help smallholder farms around the world increase crop yields by detecting pests and diseases using just their smartphone. Here's Jiva's CEO, Ram Mahadevan.
Take a picture of the disease spot and
See you, Brian.
I was just showing her your recipe.
Okay.
I was just showing it to her.
You guys gonna catch it from here?
Yeah, we gonna catch it right here.
Okay. I'll hey, see you.
All right, Rob. See ya.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.